BBC4 with a new album out and still going strong at 70, musicians, writers and performers salute the godfather of gloom, Leonard Cohen.
I think he looks absolutely gorgeous.
If I look like when I'm 70.
All kinds of people love Cohen. These days he may be fairly reclusive, but he is still Canada's greatest cult export. His doom-laden lyrics have spawned generations of morose goths and earned him the reputation as the most miserable man in pop. Prior to his long and successful career in the music business, he was an acclaimed poet and had published two novels.
Both are yellow, much red.
Au revoir.
Merci.
Here I stand. I'm your man.
But Leonard Cohen provokes extreme reactions. You either love him or you hate him.
Sometimes you get the feeling that Leonard Cohen could sing anything and it's going to sound convincing and beautiful.
Well, of course, the cliche is that it's wrist-slitting music, that it's people at home in their beds chewing their hearts out in solitary misery and lovelorn melancholia. Although, of course, as we real aficionados of Leonard know, he's a lot more to him than that.
And if you got a sleeper moment on the road, I will steal for you.
The voice sounds kind of authentic in some way. It's Leonard Cohen, it couldn't be anybody else, and it seems true.
Cohen is a musician's musician. These days it would be hard to find a singer-songwriter who doesn't claim to be a huge Cohen fan.
I love his songs because he makes you shiver, makes me tingle.
I'm your man.
Fantasy-wise, he is definitely my little black dress.
He's a Barry White for poetry chicks.
Now so long.
So here we are, Leonard Cohen, the ultimate oxymoronic karaoke night.
Like a bird.
And even though his detractors may describe his lyrics as painful dirges, he's still the connoisseur's choice at karaoke.
Ladies and gentlemen, Leonard Cohen.
It's true that all the men you knew were dealers who said they were through with dealing every time you gave them shelter.
Cohen was in his mid-30s when his first album, Songs of Leonard Cohen, was released, positively middle-aged by music business standards.
For the sky just to surrender.
Here was a new Bob Dylan, if you like.
For the sky just to surrender.
Singer-songwriter of some worth. But really, you know, he was 10 years older than anyone else that was hip at the time. And he was too sort of middle class to be a beatnik.
I loved his car, which he wore like a snail shell everywhere.
So Cohen wasn't your ordinary rock star. He'd already found fame as a poet and intellectual in his native Montreal. But finding it hard to make money writing poems, he decided to try his luck writing songs. His destiny was sealed in 1967 when he supported folk singer Judy Collins. The unlikely performer was promptly signed up to make his first album.
We all loved the story about him when he did his first version of Suzanne, first time he'd ever appeared on stage, and he burst into tears halfway through and had to go off to be comforted by Judy Collins or something. You know, we all loved this idea of this tortured, sensitive soul, and he's a poet. I mean, he's a proper poet.
By the mid-70s, Cohen had released 5 records and become something of a cult hero. Although many people had heard his name, they hadn't all heard his songs.
All the sisters of mercy, they are not departed or gone.
Leonard Cohen, in the beginning of singing his songs, is very cultish. Those who knew, knew.
They were waiting for me when I thought that I just can't go.
It had a lot of glamour about it, and if you were interested in, you know, something that seemed special and unusual, then you would have an absolute, undying fascination with Leonard Cohen, because it was such a great glamorous mix.
I had an older brother who didn't even know who he was, and I always looked up to my older brother as, you know, the intelligent dude you want to impress, so there was that kind of thing as well. It's like, I've got this Leonard Cohen dude and you're still listening to rubbish, like, yes.
Shouldering your loneliness.
I first heard Leonard Cohen in Wangaratta, in a girlfriend of mine's house. she'd managed to get this record called Songs of Love and Hate. And you've got to understand that the climate in this particular town was ultra-conservative. People just didn't know about anything, let alone Leonard Cohen. And it was just the strangest music I'd ever heard. And I guess in some way it was this, you know, you had this secret thing that you liked, that you knew nobody else in my country town even would ever hear.
And Jane came by with a lock of your hair.
The first album I got, I think, was The Greatest Hits. There was a melancholy sound to it. I don't know whether it was particularly dark, it was beautiful as much as dark, you know, and it just had a different light to it. It was moonlight rather than, you know, the poppy sunlight of most of the stuff around then.
I was working in a bar in Liverpool, and one night I went to play Scrabble back at this man's house in his bedsit, and he put Leonard Cohen on, and I got very confused and thought that I was in love with the man, but I was actually in love with Leonard Cohen.
Like a bird on the wire, like a drone in an old midnight choir, I have tried in my way to be free.
You know, he has that like kind of soft, seductive tones, and he speaks slowly but in perfect form, seductive sentences.
There's just something enormously comforting about Leonard Cohen's voice, that when you listen to it, you feel like you're being spoken to directly. He just has this voice from on high.
Your voice seems to have got deeper, listening to some of the earlier albums.
Yeah, it's gotten deeper. It's about 100,000 cigarettes deeper. Wise men say only fools rush in.
Very attractive. It's like rough velvet.
It's the poetry of his lyrics, say his most passionate fans, that sets Cohen above his contemporaries.
It's how I first came to Leonard Cohen. You know, the idea that there was this kind of interesting, kind of odd Canadian who seemed to come out of a world of Arthur Rimbaud and Baudelaire, trying to make sense of the universe, you know, the great kind of life and death struggles, God, sex, beauty, power, the whole thing that is in his songs. It was already well embedded in the poems.
This is Diamonds in the Mine by Leonard Cohen. The woman in blue, she's asking for revenge. The man in white, that's you, says he has no friends. The river is swollen up with rusty cans, and the trees are burning in your promised land. You can tell me that your lover has a broken limb. You say you're restless now and it's on account of him. I saw the man in question, it was just the other night. He was eating up a lady where the lions and Christians fight.
Where the lions and Christians fight.
But you just know that every lyric's going to have something, and it's going to have a line that's going to take your breath away.
There seems to be, I guess, a poet's pace about them, which you just don't hear in rock and roll.
And there are no chocolates in your boxes anymore.
Rock and roll's supposed to be immediate and kind of just some sort of outpouring from the heart. But as a contrast to that, it's really, really exciting to listen to lyrics that have been done so carefully.
I think Dylan is as adept a writer, but I don't think he's as, I wouldn't sort of classify him as a poet. I mean, I think Leonard Cohen could be like a traditional, he's a traditional poet.
One of his earlier ones starts, "It seems so long ago, Nancy was alone, looking at the late, late show through a semi-precious stone." And part of you thinks, well, what an awful pretentious, what? But actually, that line has stayed with me for years.
Well, just this kind of twist that he puts on things, that's kind of what I learned from him, I think. To set a verse up and then pull the rug from under it in a way at the end, and then a simple chorus.
And so even though as a poet he might have